Come we that love the Lord and let our joys we know. Join in a song of sweet accord. Join in a song of sweet accord. And the song.
For this day we have to come and to worship you and to sing these songs of praise to your name and to lift your name up. Father, we pray that we'll do so with a joyful heart, and we'll sing these praises with adoration to you and place you on high above everything else in this world, and concentrate and put our mind to the glory and wonder that you have given to us. Father, there are many who are sick and going through many trials this time. We pray you be with those and help us to encourage them. And Father, pray that be with those who are leading this worship this morning, that they'll direct our minds to you and to your word. Father, most of all, we thank you for your Son as sacrificed for us and through whom all we have all blessings. And after this world is gone, we will have a place with you in heaven. In Christ's name we pray. Amen.
On a hill far away stood an old rugged cross, the emblem of suffering and shame. And I love that old cross where the tears stand less for a
church family. So thankful that we have this book that tells us the rest of the story on so many things. We are so fortunate to have, when you think about through, as you read through this book, all the individuals who didn't have the rest of the story when they were going through it. And I can think of Noah and all the people around him as he was building that ark. I don't think they had the rest of the story. They didn't know what was going to happen. You can think about Sarah and Abraham, how she laughed when God said she'd have a son. She didn't know the rest of the story at that time, but God did. You can think about Abraham and Isaac when he took to sacrifice his only son. I think Abraham knew the rest of the story at that time, that God would provide for him another way. You go through this book and there's so many examples of just individuals. Moses, Job, Ruth. You look at Paul and their lives, and you look through all of their lives, and God has left us with this book that tells us the rest of the story, and it's amazing. When Jesus was on the cross, I lost my place here. I was right there in in Mark. I can't imagine that those individuals who were standing nearby had the rest of the story at that time. It says in Mark chapter 15, starting in verse 33, "Now when the sixth hour had come, there was darkness over the whole land until the ninth hour. And at the ninth hour, Jesus cried out with a loud voice, saying, Eloi, Eloi, lama sabachthani, which is translated, my God, why have you forsaken me? Some of those who stood by, when they heard that, said, look, he's calling for Elijah. Then someone ran and filled a sponge with sour wine, put it on a reed and offered to him to drink, saying, let him alone. Let us see if Elijah will come and take him down. And Jesus cried out with a loud voice and breathed his last." I can't imagine the uncertainty at that time, those who were around him. When he breathed his last, they had been told that he had told them all this time, I'm coming back. This is not the end. But they didn't have this book. They didn't have this book at that time. And I would hope that I would be faithful enough to, you know, believe in those times. But thankfully, I mean, in a way, I'm glad I wasn't there. And I have this complete version of this book. I know how it ends. I know that uncertainty breeds stress and all the things that go on with it. And we live in uncertain times. But when you read through his word, we have this book. We have this completed book that tells us the ending, that tells us the story, that tells us that this world's not our home. It doesn't matter. Anything that goes on here is, we're just basically filling time is what we're doing until Jesus comes back. Paul says in 2 Corinthians in chapter 4, starting in verse 16, "Therefore we do not lose heart, even though our outward man is perishing, yet the inward man is being renewed day by day. For our light affliction, which is but a moment, is working for us far more exceeding an eternal weight of glory. While we do not look at the things which are seen, but at the things which are not seen. For the things which are seen are temporary, but the things which are not seen are eternal." This whole book, I'm glad I know the story. And you know what? Every person in this world was created in God's image. But unfortunately, not everybody knows this story as far as it goes. We come together each first day of the week to celebrate the gift that he gave us, that he came to this earth, was tempted in every way that we are, but didn't sin, and his reward was to be sacrificed for our sins. We're commemorating this until he comes back. We do this until he comes back to give thanks to him for all that he's done for us. Let's pray. Father God in heaven, we thank you so much for this day. We thank you for this communion that you have left for us, that you've taught us in your word, the instructions that you've left us, that command us to do these things, that lead us in a way to tell us how we should worship you, that tell us these things, Father. We're so thankful that you have left these things for us. But Father, we pray that every time that we come and we take this communion, that we do it in a way that's reverent to you, Father, and we do it in a way that pleases you. For none of this is about us, Father. It's about you and that great and awesome gift that you gave us. We pray as we partake of this bread that we would be mindful of the cost that it was, that the pain and the suffering that you went through, the ridicule, the things that we have no idea how brutal they could have been or how brutal they were in our feeble minds to understand that. But we thank you for all you've done for us. And we just pray that we please you as we do this. It's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Not a person in this world knows what will happen tomorrow or the next day or the next day, but God does. And to be honest with you, it doesn't matter, as I was saying, anything that goes on, as long as we have this book, we have this completed story, that all we got to do is follow it. All we got to do is listen to his word as he talks to us. Let's give thanks for this cup, which represents his shed blood that he died for us. Father God in heaven, we thank you for this fruit of the vine, which represents your shed blood that cleanses us of our sins, Father. And we are all sinful people. None of us are perfect, Father. And we pray that as we partake of this, we will remember the cost that it was, Father, that you gave so that we could be with you in eternity, Father, with you in heaven one day, Father. And I pray that each and every one of us that partake of this do it in a way that pleases you and that we will do it until our time comes to be with you, Father. I pray that you would always keep us faithful to following your word and all that we do. Thank you so much for your son, Jesus Christ. In his name we pray. Amen.
Today's scripture reading will be taken from Genesis chapter 32, verses 22 through 32. During the night, Jacob got up and took his two wives, his two slave women, and his 11 sons and crossed the ford of Jabbok. He took them and sent them across the stream along with all his possessions. Jacob was left alone, and a man wrestled with him until daybreak. When the man saw that he could not defeat him, he struck Jacob's hip socket as they wrestled and dislocated his hip. Then he said to Jacob, "Let me go, for it is daybreak." But Jacob said, "I will not let you go unless you bless me." "What is your name?" the man asked. "Jacob," he replied. "Your name will no longer be Jacob," he said. "It will be Israel, because you have struggled with God and with men and have prevailed." Then Jacob asked him, "Please tell me your name." But he answered, "Why do you ask my name?" And he blessed him there. Jacob then named the place Peniel, "For I have seen God face to face," he said. "Yet my life had been spared. The sun shone on him as he passed by Peniel, limping because of his hip. This is why still today the Israelites don't eat the thigh muscle that is at the top of the hip socket, because he struck Jacob's hip socket at the thigh muscle."
Let's stand for this song.
Oh, what a wonderful, wonderful day, day I will never forget. After I wandered in darkness away, Jesus, my Savior, I met. Oh, what a tender, compassionate friend, he met the need of my heart. Showers of spelling the joy I'm telling, he made all the darkness depart. Heaven came down and glory filled my soul.
You're here, especially those of you who are our guests. We're delighted you've chosen to come and worship with us today. Hope you can come back and be with us often. And as we always say, if you're looking for a church home, just welcome home. Love to have you as part of the family here. I want to start this morning with a question. I think it's an appropriate question for the season of our life that we find ourselves living in. What do we do when life is difficult? What do we do when we're presented with challenges? What do we do when things are awkward? What do we do when life is just hard? Open your Bibles to Genesis chapter 25. We're going to let a man by the name of Jacob. Craig, here's some more of the story. Craig mentioned Abraham and Isaac. We're going to look at Jacob this morning. We're going to see how Jacob would answer that question. What do you do when life is difficult? Well, I'll just tell you at the get-go here, Jacob was a runner. Jacob was a guy who runs away from difficult conversations. Jacob is a guy who runs away from difficult circumstances. Jacob is a guy who runs away from difficult consequences. And my guess is that Jacob isn't the only person we know who runs away from that kind of stuff. We might know some people pretty intimately that do the same thing. See, Jacob had every reason to deal with difficulties in a proper manner. I mean, think about his heritage. Craig's already mentioned Abraham and Isaac. I mean, he's the grandson of Abraham. He's the son of Isaac. Can you imagine when their family got together? Can you imagine hearing the stories about how God chose Abraham? Can you imagine those stories about those promises that God made to Abraham? That he'd be the father of a great multitude, a great nation. Through him, all the nations of the earth would be blessed. All the peoples of the earth are going to be blessed. And maybe they sat around and they held hands and sang, Father Abraham had many sons, many. I don't know if that's where that originated, but it's a possibility. That's all my story. Let's get to the real story. In Genesis chapter 25, verses 25 and 26, we see the birth of Jacob. We see the birth, first of all, of his twin brother Esau. Jacob, this guy who in life is going to be running from things, in a sense, he's running to his brother as he grabs onto the heel of his older brother Esau as they're coming out of the womb. And his name, Jacob, one meaning of his name is that he to be taken by the heel. So he's trying to trip his brother up in the very beginning, maybe. I don't know. Maybe I'm reading too much into that. But these two boys are born, Jacob, his older brother Esau, and they're, even though they're twins, they're quite different. Esau, he comes out and he's red. He's hairy. He's going to end up, Genesis chapter 25, verse 27, he's going to be a hunter. He's going to be an outdoorsman type. You might even want to call him red. Because later on, he likes red stew too. So we're going to call him red if you want to. You can call him a hairy hunter. I don't know. You can call him whatever. But Jacob's older brother, he's quite different than Jacob. The Bible tells us in Genesis 25, verse 28, that Isaac loved Esau, but it also tells us that Jacob's mother, Rachel, loved Jacob. Jacob, quite different. He's a quiet type, the Bible says. Genesis 25, verse 27. He's more of a homebody. More of a homebody. Maybe as we look at his life, as we go through some of his life today, maybe he's sitting at home and he's scheming and he's plotting and he's planning how he can trip up his brother, that one he tried to grab by the heel when he was born. May not have trapped him at birth, but he's going to trap him later. And we discover that he does trap him, that he does take his brother's birthright away from him. But probably the highlight of the story here as we look at this story is as we read about Jacob and how he dealt with difficult things in life. Isaac sends Esau out to get some game and come home and prepare a meal. And Jacob's mother, Rebekah, she learns about this. And so she tells her son and they get a plot together. I don't know who gets all the blame for that, but they plan on stealing or taking away the blessing. Taking away the blessing. I mean, Jacob has already got the birthright from his brother, Esau. Sold it for that red stew. And so now Jacob is after that blessing. And so he and his mother, again, they get this plot together and they put some goat's hair on Jacob's hands and his neck. Mom gets some of Esau's garments, probably smell like a hunter. You know how the hunters smell, don't you? And Isaac, in his old age, nearly blind, he tricks his father and he gains the blessing. He got what he wanted. Got what he wanted maybe from birth. Well, he's got it now. And what comes with that selfish acquirement? Or consequences. Consequences. Jacob just thought he may have had some difficulties before. Now they really begin. Genesis chapter 27, verses 35 and 36. After Isaac had found out what Jacob had done, he told his brother Esau. He said, your brother came deceitfully, Genesis 27, verse 35, and he has taken away your blessing. And Esau said, is he not rightly named Jacob? For he has cheated me these two times. He took away my birthright, and behold, now he has taken away my blessing. Cheater. That's what Jacob means as well. In addition to taking by the heel, it means cheater. Wouldn't you hate to have a name that meant cheater? Well, that's Jacob. That's Jacob. And you continue reading in the text there down at verse 41 says that now Esau, this is some powerful language here. Now Esau hated Jacob because of the blessing with which his father had blessed him. And Esau said to himself, the days of mourning for my father are approaching. Then I will kill my brother Jacob. What do you do when life is difficult? That's Jacob's life. Well, Jacob, he's going to run. Remember, Jacob's a runner. Rebecca, Jacob's mother, she learns of this. And she tells Jacob in verse number 43, arise and flee to Laban. My brother, your uncle, go to Laban. Jacob, it's time to run. See, Jacob is a guy who runs away from difficulties. He's a guy that runs away from difficult circumstances, difficult situation, difficult conflicts. He runs to his Uncle Laban. And you know what he finds at Uncle Laban's house? He gets a taste of his own medicine. He's going to learn what deceit does to you when you're the one being deceived. He's going to learn what it means to be cheated out of something. You see, he is deceived and cheated by Laban. He found a wife when he got there. Rachel, the younger of Laban's sisters. She's younger, she's beautiful. He worked 7 years to acquire her as his wife. And guess what he found out? Guess what happened? Deception. He's cheated. He gets Leah. He gets the older and less attractive daughter. So he works 7 more years. 14 years, and he finally gets a wife. On top of all that, in his dealings with his father-in-law, he tells his wives at a point later that we'll look at in just a moment, he tells his wives that your father has cheated me. He's deceived me. He's changed my wages 10 times. See, old Jacob knows what it's like to have things taken away from you. He's learning some lessons here. So what do you do? Again, difficult situations, difficult circumstances. What do you do when your brother's after you? Well, you run. What do you do when you're having problems with your father-in-law? Well, Jacob's going to run. Genesis chapter 31, verse 21 tells us that Jacob would flee. He fled. See, Jacob did not want to have the difficult conversations. Jacob did not want to deal with the difficult conflict. Jacob runs away. You know, when I read through this story, and what I think might be true is that Jacob's story is not that much different from some of our stories. Did you ever run away from a difficult conversation? What about a difficult situation? Are we runners? Sometimes we run away in silence. Psychologists call that being passive. That is, we don't say anything. We don't do anything. We're like, kind of like Adam in Genesis chapter 3, verses 1 through 7. You see, Adam runs by standing by in silence. You see, he's right there with Eve, right there with that old serpent. Something needed to be done. Something needed to be said. And Adam did nothing, and Adam said nothing. Sometimes we may run not in silence, but we run in violence. See, sometimes we run as we unplug. That is, we're not engaged. I'm not going to get involved. But sometimes we run when we explode in violence. A great example of that, I think, might be the life of Samson, Judges 13 through 16. Good reading this afternoon for you. Samson would go back and forth from being silent to being violent. You know, sometimes when we look at violence, we look at it in the Bible, we look at it in our lives, you know, violence can be very toxic. Say, well, duh, I get that. I mean, toxic in the sense that we use our God-given strength to hurt and not help. We use our God-given strength, abilities to demand things from ourselves rather than to deny ourselves. You know, there's nothing biblical, there's nothing Christ-like about being rough with something or someone that's fragile. There's nothing biblical nor Christ-like about dominating the weak. You know, when I see Jacob, sometimes I might see myself. What about you? When we see Jacob, do we see us? Do we see our lives challenged by difficulties? See, Jacob, as you read through his story, again, some good reading this afternoon if you want to, Genesis 27 through 32, and a little further if you want to continue. You know, Jacob is the guy that would play victim. Any of us ever guilty of that in our running? Jacob's the kind of guy that would manipulate people and situations. Are we ever guilty of that? Jacob is the guy that would run away from his commitments. Jacob's the kind of guy that, you know, I just don't want to take a stand. Jacob's a guy that's running, refusing his responsibilities. Am I ever guilty of that? Maybe not being truthful all the time. As Jacob ran away, Jacob and his family ran away from Laban, his father-in-law. Laban caught up with him. In Genesis chapter 31, verse 31, Laban asked him, why'd you run away, Jacob? And here's what Jacob says, because I was afraid, for I thought that you would take your daughters from me by force. There's probably some truth in that. But the bottom line truth is, Jacob's all about himself. Jacob's all about running away from things he doesn't want to deal with. And we see the heart of Jacob on down in the passage there, verse number 36. Jacob became angry, the Bible tells us. Jacob became angry and berated Laban. Do you see who Jacob really is? Oh, he might be silent at times and just run away, but sometimes he can get pretty violent. The words he would say to his father-in-law. But listen, let's not get depressed here. There is a glimmer of hope in this confrontation that he's having with his father-in-law. Verse number 42 of chapter 31, we discover that Jacob is aware of God's blessing. He remembers God's blessing. Remember when he first ran away from home? When Esau was looking to kill him and he's headed off, he stops at this place and pillows his head on a rock. He has this dream. Jacob's ladder. We're all familiar with that story, aren't we? Now, you're probably not going to have the same dream if you try to lay your head on the rock and go to sleep. But, you know, it happened to Jacob. And here's what Jacob learned in that dream. God came to him and told him these words. He says, I'm never going to leave you. I'll be with you wherever you go. And I'm going to bring you back to where you're supposed to be. I'm going to bring you back to the land. And he says, I'll never leave you until I have fulfilled my promise to you. And Jacob, in this difficulty, in this confrontation here, he's trying to run away from Laban, but I think he remembers that. He remembers that God's made a promise to him to be with him and to bring him back. He makes a covenant with Laban. Jacob is ready to stop running. Because you see, you can't run forever. Eventually, it will all catch up with you? Have you found that out in life yet? You can run and run and run, but eventually you just can't run long enough. You just can't run far enough till everything catches up with you. I think that's Jacob. I think that may be us, some of us, at times in our life. We're in a series that we started 2 weeks ago, Never Going Back to Normal. You know, if we've been running from difficult things in our life, now's the time to stop it. During this pandemic, I think we have discovered that we're in a mess. Things just aren't the way they ought to be. Well, what are we going to do? Oh, we can run and run and run and run, either in silence or violence. We can either be passive or aggressive, or we can be a little bit of both. But what we see in Jacob, he says, I'm never going back to that normal again. So after this confrontation with Laban, he makes up his mind he's going to go back to his brother. Wow. And he runs toward the difficulty instead of running away from the difficulty. In Genesis chapter 32, we see Jacob, and he sends messengers to his brother. As they're approaching, coming together, he sends some messengers to his brother. He tells those messengers to tell Esau that look, I'm coming to see you, and I don't need anything from you. I've got all these possessions. As a matter of fact, he wants to give gifts to his older brother Esau. Well, the messengers go and they come back. In Genesis chapter 32, verse number 6, the messengers return to Jacob saying, we came to your brother Esau and he's coming to meet you. Now, that would have created a little tension, I would think, for Jacob, knowing who he is, what he's done in the past. But that's not all. Esau's coming to meet you, and there are 400 men with him. You thought life was difficult before, dealing with an older, almost blind father. You thought life was hard when you learned your brother's going to kill you. You thought life was hard when you've got this father-in-law that's cheated you out of what he owes you. Now you're going to meet this brother who's going to kill you. And this brother that was going to kill you, he's got 400 men with him. What do you do? Well, here's what Jacob does. Genesis 32, verse 7, we discover that he begins dividing things up. He's taking care of what things he can. He's wanting to minimize his losses, whatever's going to happen between he and his brother Esau. So he divides everything up. He doesn't just divide everything. It doesn't stop there. I mean, that's something you need to do. If you're dealing with difficulties, you need to take care of what business you can. But then Genesis chapter 32, starting at verse 9 down through verse 12, we find Jacob praying. We find him praying to God. And he's praying based on the blessing that he has received. He's praying based on the promise that God had made him there in that dream that he had. He's asked to be delivered from the hand of his brother. So he's done all he can do physically himself. Now he's dealt with the spiritual side of it. He's talked to God, but he's not finished there. Genesis chapter 32, verse 24, the Bible tells us that Jacob was left alone. Have you ever been running and running and running? You've done all you can do. You prayed to God, and now it's just you. That's Jacob. You know what you do when there's just you? Start doing a lot of reflecting. Start looking within. And while Jacob's doing that, this man appears. This man appears and enters into a wrestling match with Jacob. They wrestle all night long. Jacob must be a pretty good wrestler because he's hanging in there. Especially when we discover who this is. This man that comes to wrestle with Jacob. And by the way, the man comes. Jacob didn't pick the fight. The man came to him. The man initiated the wrestling match. And this man, as you read through this story here, as Jacob looks back on what happened, he says, I've seen the face of God. what? Wait a minute. This man? You've seen the face of God in this man? You read Hosea's story in chapter 12, verse number 4, I think it is. Hosea calls this man that Jacob wrestled with the angel. Not just an angel, but the angel. I think there may be a little significance in the angel. You see, my understanding of this, understanding of people who are scholars, I'm not a scholar, is that this is a pre-incarnate Jesus who comes and wrestles with Jacob. They wrestle all night long. Folks, God can wrestle all night long with you. Sin wrestles all night long with you sometimes, doesn't it? Well, God's right there with you. He'll wrestle with you with the sin. But is God struggling with Jacob here through this man who's wrestling with Jacob? He stops the wrestling match with a touch. The word for he touches Jacob's hip is the word for a light touch. See, a light touch won't stop a man that's been wrestling with you all night long. But the light touch of God will stop you in your tracks. See, God doesn't play by the rules. Say, well, that's not fair. And? What's your point? God doesn't play by the rules. God makes the rules. Have you ever had your life put out of joint by God before? It's just a light touch. But it gets our attention. Some setback, some disappointment, some difficulty. It brings us to our senses, hopefully. That's God's intention. And what it lets us know is just how weak we really are. It lets us know how helpless we really are. And so what we have as this wrestling match ends here, we have this patriarch, Jacob, limping forward. But things have really changed for him. In addition to the limp, in addition to the bad hip, he's got a new name. And guess what he needed as much as anything else? He needed a new name. If your name's Cheater, you need a new name. And the new name he gets is Israel, which means to strive with God or to struggle with God. So, well, I don't know if I want that name. See, when you look at some other names in the Bible, names with the same ending, for example, like Daniel. Daniel means God judges. See, it doesn't mean that he judges God. See, sometimes we look at Jacob and say, well, he wrestled with God. That's what it means. Well, no, wait a minute. Hold on. Daniel's name means that God judges, not that he judges God. Or Samuel. Samuel's name doesn't mean that he heard. It means that God heard. You see, God is the subject, not the object. And I think that's the case with this wrestling match here and this new name change. It doesn't mean that Jacob wrestled with God. That is, Jacob is the subject and God is the object. It means just the same as Daniel's name and Samuel's name. It means that God struggled with Jacob. And you know what happens when God struggles with us? Can I tell you what will happen if you get in a fight with God? God will always prevail. Always prevail. So that new name is indicative that Jacob lost. Jacob lost. Now he's limping forward. But he's limping forward and is losing victoriously. Isn't that what Jesus said in Matthew chapter 16, verse 25? As we limp forward in life, here's the way we limp. Whoever would save his life will lose it. That is, if you want to win in life, you're going to lose. But whoever loses his life for my sake will find it. If you lose your life, guess what you do? You win your life. You win life from God. God gives you life. So here's Jacob limping forward. limping forward victoriously. Folks, I don't know if you realize it or not, but we've had a setback, haven't we? We've had some difficulties in life the last few months, and it seems to continue on. Maybe we needed a pandemic. I'm not going to question God. He's in control. Maybe we needed just to stop and reflect a little bit. Any of you wrestled with God during the pandemic? Trying to figure things out? Why is this happening? Any of you stopped, slowed down enough? You had to slow down enough? You had no other choice to say, is there anything wrong with me? Is there anything I need to change in my life? Never going back to normal. That's what I've learned in this pandemic. I'm not going back to running away from the difficult conversations. I'm never going back to running away from the awkward circumstances. I'm never going back from running away anymore. I'm just going to limp forward victoriously in God's strength. How about you? See, because I think normal before was, I've got this thing under control. I've grabbed it by the heel. I've tripped everything up in life, and I'm running life the way I want to. Oh, I may be running, but I'm in control. Never going back to normal. Never going back to normal. Y'all wonder if anyone ever asked Jacob, hey, bro, what's wrong with your hip? What's wrong? Where'd the limp come from? You know they did. People do me that way sometimes, you know. I'll tell them about my experience. I don't know how long. It's been a long time ago now. So I got a reason to limp sometimes. And I can just hear Jacob, somebody ask him what's wrong. He'll say, excuse me, the name's not Jacob anymore. My name's Israel. God has struggled with me, and he won. And that's why I limp. But I'm limping forward with him right now. I'm not running anymore. I'm not running anymore. I'm just going to limp along, limp forward with God as my strength. See, Jacob's life has been changed. It's changed to the point that it's going to impact other people. We can't close without looking at this meeting with Jacob and his brother Esau. Genesis chapter 33, verse 4. Esau ran to meet him and embraced him and fell on his neck and kissed him, and they wept. You know, that's not at all how I would picture this reunion. I'm thinking conflict. I'm thinking a battle. I'm thinking, Jacob, you're really going to lose. But see, Jacob's already lost, but he won. It's changed his life, and now his life is going to impact and change his brother's life. See, when you get these two together, I would think we're going to air everything out. We're going to get it all out on the table. I'm going to get all this off my chest. I'm going to let you know what for. Whether you be Jacob or Esau. But you know what they do? They just weep. They just weep. You know that weeping shows a sign of weakness. What Paul said something about that. When I am weak, then I am strong. Isn't that in the Bible, Jeff? It's there, isn't it? Yeah. When I'm weak, then I'm strong. We cry about a lot of stuff, don't we? You know when you really need to cry? I saw a lady this week in my office. Tears flowing down her cheeks. You know what she's crying about? Reconciliation. Let me ask you a question. Do we weep over reconciliation? That's what Jacob and Esau are doing here. They're weeping over reconciliation. When's the last time we have wept about our reconciliation to God? When's the last time we have wept about others being reconciled to God? We've got a form out in the foyer we put out there today. We want names to put on the mailing list for house to house, heart to heart. Can I tell you why we want those names? Not so we'll have a big, huge mailing list. Not so we can really impress the house-to-house, heart-to-heart people and say, man, that church, they're mailing those things out. You know why we want those names? Those are lost souls. Those are people who need to be reconciled to God. We can stand up here and twist arms. We can stand up here and plead. We can even manipulate. We can do peer pressure. Can I tell you what will get names on a list? Tears. Weeping. Until we become people who weep over reconciliation. We'll just keep running. Won't we? I'm never going back to normal. I'm just going to limp along, weeping. Dealing with difficult conversations, awkward circumstances, difficult consequences. Never going back to normal. What do you do? What do you do when life is difficult? I think it's time to wrestle with God. How about you? And the answer is, we've got to lose myself. Are you ready to lose yourself by becoming a Christian, a child of God? Are you ready to gain yourself, to gain life in Christ? See, if you're not a Christian, you can be baptized into Christ this morning based on your faith, repentance, and confession. You can do that. And God will raise you up to walk in newness of life. I think more accurately, as we look at the lesson this morning, God will raise you up to limp along in newness of life. Because you see, He's the strength. It's not in us. It's in Him. As a child of His, maybe you need to come limping back to Him this morning because you've been running. Jacob ran for 2 decades plus. Some of you here this morning may have been running for 2 decades. Don't run any more decades. Let today be the day that you're reconciled with God. If you need reconciliation, I'll be down front to help you in any way I can. While we stand, while we sing.
We shall assemble on the mountain. We shall assemble at the throne. With humble hearts into His presence, we bring an offering of song.
Hallelujah, hallelujah, oh, hallelujah. Father in heaven, we bow our heads in your assembly here this morning with great fear and trembling and awesomeness, because we know that we're coming into the Creator, the God of the universe. But Father, we pray that you will look into our hearts and find a spirit of reverence, respect, awe, and fear of your goodness and your greatness in this world. And Father, we thank you for Jack's lesson this morning. But help us to remember also that you've given us a new name. It's a name called Christian. And as we separate, we carry that name with us. And help us to remember what it represents. We thank you for Jack's reminder this morning of so many people in this world who are lost. Father, help us to try to comprehend that there are billions and billions of people in this world who are going to face eternity without knowing of your love, without knowing of your plan of salvation, without knowing the plan of escape from eternal torment that we have in our hands. And help us to be able to share that with so many people that we come in contact with as we carry the name Christ with us. And help us to be ministers of change in their lives so that they can know just how wonderful and how great your love for us is when they look at the cross and see Jesus. Father, we pray for strength. We pray for wisdom. We pray for opportunities to teach. We pray for the food pantry as they come in contact with people every day. And this is an example of the second command in action, that loving our neighbor as ourself is obeying your word. So help us to remember to keep your word close to our hearts and close to our actions and close to our words that we utter. Help us to share the love and the peace that comes from knowing of Jesus and his death on the cross, that we have a lot of suffering and time and troubles to go through here, but we can one day be able to see the face of God in his presence when we cease to exist here. And that's a destiny all of us face. So be with us as we strive to serve you, to praise you, and to glorify your name. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.